Amen. And let me thank Brother Tyrone Hall and all of our worship participants. Can we give God praise for them? And we honor the Trustee Board Ministry of Flipper Temple. Come on and give God praise for the entire Trustee Board Ministry. I'm going to ask the members of Usher Board number one to please stand. They are in the rear, so if you would just take a look in the rear of your church. They are here today also to celebrate an annual day and give a special donation to Flipper Temple. So go ahead and give God praise for the members, the marvelous members of Usher Red Board number one. Amen. And beloved, let me also thank God for our stewards and our ushers, other ushers, and those who are serving in audio visual ministry. I'm thankful for Sister Deborah Lewis and her reading of the scripture, but if you have your Bibles or your smartphones, iPads, let me ask you to join me at the 8th chapter of the book of Acts. The 8th chapter of the book of Acts. And I want to read a few verses beginning at verse 26. Acts chapter 8, beginning at verse 26. Now an angel of the Lord spoke to Philip, saying, "Arise and go toward the south along the road that goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza. This is desert." And verse 27 says, "And he arose and went, and behold, a man of Ethiopia, a eunuch of great authority, under Candace, the queen of the Ethiopians, who had charge of all her treasury. He had come to Jerusalem in order to worship. And as he returned, he was sitting in his chariot, reading Isaiah the prophet. Then the Spirit said to Philip, 'Go near and overtake the chariot.' So Philip ran, heard him reading the prophet Isaiah, and said, 'Do you understand what you are reading?'" And then verse 37, I'm going to skip down to verse 37. "Then Philip said, 'If you believe with all your heart, you may.' And he answered, 'I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God.' So he commanded the chariot to stand still, and both Philip and the eunuch went down into the water, and Philip baptized him. And when they came up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord caught Philip away, so that the eunuch saw him no more, but he went on his way rejoicing." Shall we pray? Gracious Lord, we thank you for your word, a lamp unto our feet, a light unto our path. We thank you, Lord, for your word that gives strength, power for living, and focus. We want to say thank you. Now, Lord, we simply ask you to speak, for your servants are listening. Consecrate us to your service by the power of grace divine. Let our souls look up with a steadfast hope, and our wheels be lost in thine. In Jesus' name we pray. Let the church say amen, 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 and amen. I'm going to lift up verse 35 once again. And that word says, "Then Philip opened his mouth, and beginning with this scripture, preached Jesus to the eunuch." I want to use for a subject this morning the spirit of an evangelist. The spirit of an evangelist. Brothers and sisters, I believe what the church needs more than anything else in our day is an evangelistic spirit. A spirit that leads others to a saving knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. The sad reality of life is that in traditional churches, very few people share their faith outside the sacred space in which we occupy. But statistics let us know that more than 100,000 churches across America are in decline, and if they do not grow in the next decades, they are in grave danger of dying. So, brothers and sisters, we are called as a congregation and as a fellowship of believers to share our faith. Now, sharing our faith does not have to be a complicated exercise. We do not have to know the Bible from cover to cover. We do not have to know the ins and outs of systematic and biblical theology. In order to share our faith, we simply have to make it simple. Be authentic and depend on the power and presence of the Holy Spirit to lead us. Brothers and sisters, we need evangelists in the pulpit. Many of us who preach God's word, the only time we talk about the Lord is when we are standing before our congregation on Sunday morning. We need evangelists in the major ministries of our church. We need evangelists on our steward board and our trustee board, among our class leaders, in our choir, on our usher board, in the missionary society, the lay organization. We need evangelists in our congregation to stand up and let the world know that we have faith that is worth sharing. So, brothers and sisters, God is calling us to live out the Great Commission. You know, over in Matthew chapter 28, verses 19 and 20, it is not an option, it is a command. When the Lord admonishes us to go, make disciples of all nations. Now notice, it just didn't say go make church members. It said go make disciples. And notice now, there is no limitation on discipleship making. Go make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And when we engage in the Great Commission, the Lord promises to be with us even to the end of the age. Brothers and sisters, faith sharing is a needed exercise in the body of Christ. I believe that we ought to practice faith sharing. Just as the choir practices a couple of times a week before they minister on Sunday morning, as a body of Christ, we need to practice sharing our faith. Nothing wrong with practicing how we can present the Lord Jesus Christ to a world that is in desperate need of the love of God. Brothers and sisters, there are people who are hurting all around us. On our jobs, people dress nice. They talk well. They present themselves well where they live and what they drive. But there are some things lacking in their lives. And they need a word from the Lord. There may be somebody that walked in church this Sunday morning that desperately needs to hear a word from the Lord. They hear it from the choir. They hear it from the pulpit. But sometimes our smile speaks more than our words. So, brothers and sisters, this enterprise of faith sharing and evangelism is absolutely necessary for the future of our church. The Bible gives us an example of faith sharing and an evangelistic spirit in our text. We are introduced to a young man by the name of Philip. You may remember in Acts chapter 6 that when there was a dispute in the early church over the daily distribution of food for the Hebrew and Hellenist widows, The 12 decided that it was not in order for them to leave the word of God and serve tables. So they set aside 7 men of good report, of good reputation, filled with the Holy Spirit. And one of these men were a person by the name of Philip. Later on in the book of Acts, Philip was called the evangelist. He had 4 daughters who followed in his footsteps, and they were called prophetess. So Philip provides for us an excellent example of what it means to have the spirit of an evangelist. Well, I want to leave you with 3 things that this text really points out to us that we ought to possess if we're going to have a spirit of evangelism. First of all, the text says to us that we must be directed by God. We must be directed by God. Look at the word in verse 26 with me. The word says that the angel of the Lord spoke to Philip. Now, the angel of the Lord represented the Spirit of God that lived in Philip. Now, let me make a couple of things clear. When we are saved and born again, the Holy Spirit lives within us. We must learn to listen to the voice of God through the Holy Spirit as the Holy Spirit directs us on where to go, what to say, and what to do. In this place, the word says an angel of the Lord spoke to Philip and admonished him to rise, go toward the south, along the road that leads from Jerusalem to Gaza. It's a desert road. And while Philip was on the way, God led him to his destination. Now notice here that the destination was not a place, but the destination was a person. And notice here in verse 27 that the Lord led Philip to an African man, a man of Ethiopia. Now notice some characteristics about this man. He drove well. The Bible says he was riding in a chariot. No doubt his economic standing was good because he had a driver. He also was reading, which meant in that day he had an awesome education. And no doubt he was one of the most prominent people in the nation of Ethiopia, because the word says that he handled all the money for the nation. If he was in America, he would be the Secretary of Treasury. But yet, the Bible says that although he had everything, there were some things missing. You know what? Just because we drive nice and dress nice and live nice doesn't mean that there's not anything we need. The Bible describes this man as a eunuch, which means that he was physically and emotionally castrated. There was no real gender identity for him. Born a man, stripped of his manhood, but yet in his eunuch condition, he still excelled in life. Rose to the top of his craft, but yet there was something lacking. I would like to say today, as I put a pin on that portion of the text, that there are a lot of men in America who are emasculated. Not physically, but emotionally, vocationally, criminally, politically, educationally, castrated and emasculated. Men have via me. I'm not just talking about sexually, but I'm talking about socially, even spiritually, financially, and in justice. Emasculate. But notice that Philip, led by God to the right place, at the right time, to the right person, this man went from Ethiopia to Jerusalem. He did not go on government business, didn't go for pleasure, but he went to Jerusalem in order to worship. He was seeking something. And let me say this, brothers and sisters. People who are seeking the Lord, they just don't need shallow answers. A brother came into my office the other day. His fiance was in ICU. They were getting ready to pull the plug. And he was straight up. He said, Reverend, I don't want to hear no cliches. I don't want to hear that God is too wise to make a mistake and too just to do wrong. So as I sat there in conversation with him, I just said, now, Lord, you got to tell me what to say. And the only thing I could think of was a book on my shelf. And I pulled it out and I said, well, brother, I do believe that we can question God. And I've heard most of my life growing up that we should not question God. But then the Spirit revealed to me that even Jesus questioned God. When he was hanging on the cross, he said, my God, why have thou forsaken me now? And if I might be transparent, I questioned God in my own journey. And I'm going to be real transparent. When my daughter passed away, I questioned God. Y'all with me now? That doesn't mean that my faith is any less. It doesn't mean that I'm any less of a Christian. Doesn't mean that I'm any less of a believer. But every now and then, it's all right to ask God why. God is not a surface God. We can question God. We can ask God why. So as an evangelist, Philip was directed by God, led to a black man, a man of authority, a man of position, a man of insight, led and directed by God to this brother. Now, the spirit of an evangelist is one that is directed by God. And then secondly, if we're going to have a spirit of evangelism, I believe that we must meet people where they are. Let me say that again. I want it to be clear. We must meet people where they are. Now notice in this text that this black man, Sister Compton, was reading from the book of Isaiah. Now watch this. He was not reading a passage that was unrelated to his condition. The Bible says, look at verse 32, the Bible says that he was led as a sheep to the slaughter. As a lamb before his shearer is silent, so he opened not his mouth. And as he continued to read Isaiah 53 in his humiliation, his justice was taken away. And who will declare his generation? For his life was taken from the earth. In other words, he was reading a passage of involuntary castration. Reading a passage of a man who was humiliated. Reading a passage of a man whose generation would stop at that point. No chance of continuing. Now notice one thing about Philip. Philip didn't come with his own agenda. He didn't come with his own theological doctrine. He simply met the brother where he was. When Philip talked to the man, he said, "Do you understand what you read?" And the eunuch said, "How can I understand unless someone guides me?" And you know what? The man had a question. And his question was, who was the scripture speaking to? Is it talking about some other man, or is it talking about me? Let me say it again. He said, "Philip, is this word for me? Is this a word I can hang my head on? Is this a word that will bless me in my physically debilitated condition?" You know something, brothers and sisters? If this word was only for 2,000 years ago, it is of no use today. If this word is only for its time, then it has no value for our church. But notice that this Ethiopian eunuch needed a word from the Lord. And Philip took time to communicate God's word to him, and in so doing, he met him where he was. Now let me tell you the problem of the church, and I think I can speak to it. I've been a pastor now for 34 years, and my parents drugged me to church throughout my life, so I can say a little bit about church. The problem with the church is we try to clean folks before we catch them. And if I went over your head a little bit, my grandmother used to take me fishing with her an awful lot. That's why I don't like to fish today. Fished enough. And you can't clean a fish before you catch it. And see, some of us, I ain't talking about, and I'm sure not talking about you, I guess I'm talking about your neighbor. Some of us are just too downright judgmental. Amen. Too judgmental. Meet people where they are. Meet people where they are. If they're in their mess, if we would be truthful about it while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. I better leave that alone. You know, really. Let me figure out. Come on, y'all, put the third point on the screen. But we got to meet people where they are. And the third point is on the screen. Notice now that if we're going to have the spirit of an evangelist, we must share our faith. We must share our faith. The Bible says in verse 35 that Philip opened his mouth. And notice now, he started at that scripture. Where Reverend Allen, the brother, was is where he started. Now I'm going to say something that may not fly over real well, I was invited to a conference that the United Methodist Church was having on a better way forward. Because, you know, they are struggling with the issue of gay and lesbians and whether they ought to be ordained into the Christian ministry. And they were trying to find a way to get around this impasse. And my point is this. No matter what your doctrine is, you still ought to be hospitable. Now, hear me out as I finish my point. My doctrinal thesis was on radical hospitality and how that can transform any church and really any organization. Our goal is to create an environment that is inviting, welcoming, receiving, and caring. And if we're going to create that kind of environment, then it's a whosoever will, let them come. And I know what the Bible says, and I know what the discipline says, but it also said that Jesus ate and drank with tax collectors and sinners. And sometimes I ask people, well, who would he eat and drink with today? He would eat and drink with folks who the church ostracized. I'm not pushing a doctrinal statement. I'm simply communicating. Telling is not the right word, but I'm just simply trying to communicate with each of us that we must meet people where they are, be directed by God, and share our faith. Linda may remember, some years ago, a gentleman came to our house, and with tears in his eyes, talked about how the church turned him out.
Oh, yeah.
Tears in his eyes. And God has brought me to a point where I believe if folks can't find grace in the church, where can we find? If we don't have grace to offer, where can they find it? So Philip preached Jesus to the man. And they went down the road. As I rush on to my conclusion, they went down the road. And the eunuch, Brother Blaylock, saw some water. And then he asked the question, what hinders me from being baptized? And I want to stop there for a moment. Y'all might be ready to put me out of the church. I'm going to stop there for a moment. I want to ask the question, what is it that hinders people from coming to the Lord? The man asked the question, what hinders me from being baptized? What he was really saying is, what is it that stands in the way of my joining Flipper Temple? What is it that stands in the way of my being a Christian? What is it that stands in the way of my being accepted by God? Is it my sexual orientation? Is it my sin? Is it my disposition? The fact that I can't make my subject and verb agree? What is it that stands in the way of my deliverance? What is it that keeps me away from God's grace? What hinders me from being baptized? Philip could have killed the whole thing right there. And boy, I got to sit down in a minute. Could have killed the whole thing. But he said, if you believe with all your heart. He didn't say you got to come to church every Sunday, although I would like to see you here. Didn't say that you have to sing in the choir or serve on a certain board. But he said, if you believe with all your heart, you may. And the man said, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Yes, sir. And then he commanded the chariot to stop. And the Bible says that Philip and the eunuch went down into the water. And he was baptized. And the word says that when they came up out of the water, the Spirit caught Philip. And the eunuch saw him no more. But you know the celebration point in the message is found at the end of verse 39. The word says that the eunuch went on his way rejoicing. Don't you know when you have Jesus in your life, you don't need nothing else to bring you joy. When you have Jesus, weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. When you have Jesus, you know that this joy that I have, the world didn't give it. And the world can't take it away. When you have Jesus, you can sing after all. I've been through. I've been up. I've been down. But I still have joy. Do your hands of joy. Join hands with the person next to you. While every head is bowed and every eye closed, y'all blame